It's wonderful to see so many experts, and I'm going to leave plenty of time for questioning. Our panel is really just going to be going deeper into some of the issues and questions that we were just discussing. Let me tell you, it's a wonderful panel, and we're going to hear different views because they're different people. So I'll quickly tell you who they are. First, my name's Kate Stith, and I agreed to moderate this because I thought, well, moderator, you know, what do you think? And I'm pretty busy this month. And then I got all the materials together a couple of days ago to read through them, and I saw that Tony had said, well, the moderators are going to drive the panels. Panelists, you don't have to prepare anything. But these people are always prepared. They are Sam Buell, now a professor at Washington University in St. Louis, a former member of the Enron Task Force and former assistant U.S. attorney. Brandon Garrett, now a professor at the University of Virginia Law School, where he's written many interesting articles on topics other than corporate criminal liability, but this is a new area. Mark Schonfeld was now a partner at Gibson, Dunn, formerly was with the Securities and Exchange New York Regional Office. Ted Wells, my classmate, is partner at Paul Weiss and well-known criminal defense attorney. Mary Jo White is also a well-known criminal defense attorney, head of that operation at Debevoise, I guess of all litigation, and the former U.S. attorney in the Southern District. I had planned to divide, to conduct this panel by looking at three broad topics. The first, the substance of NPAs and DPAs. Secondly, the procedures and the processes by which that content is arrived at. And third, looking at the question of the effectiveness of these. And to answer that question, of course, you have to ask what are the objectives of these, so that's a loaded question. But the last intervention by a member of the audience was very interesting at the end of the last panel, pointing out that we wouldn't be having this conference if it weren't for corporate criminal liability itself. Now, she emphasized that in federal law, and in some states, but not all states, the standard for corporate criminal liability is very low. It's essentially vicarious liability, a low standard in tort, even. But I don't want to focus on the standard, but the concept of corporate criminal liability. I teach comparative criminal law, among other things. Other countries don't have this. They don't have this in Europe. They seem to get along pretty well. They also don't have the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and other things that we have in the United States. They get along well without that, too. But I wonder if this is sort of a mistake in the development of common law jurisprudence. It can be traced back to the 19th century, no earlier. It was used primarily with respect to common law nuisance, which nuisance always was on the line between tort and crime. And it's really only in the 20th century that corporate and entity liability has been fully integrated in all the states, and the federal government began prosecuting seriously, in part because of the antitrust laws and new statutes on the books. So I want to start actually with that more general topic, again, not focusing on the vicarious liability part of it so much as the very concept of corporate criminal liability. We understand it's a useful tool now that we have it. Is there anything more to be said for it? Ted? Yes.
Okay. I don't have a lot of professorial insights as to whether the concept of corporate liability is good or bad. But I do know one thing, that the present system is broken. There's something inherently wrong with a system of justice where the person or the entity being investigated cannot afford, as a practical matter, to defend himself, herself, or itself. And the world we live in today is one where most corporations have no choice but to agree to whatever the government prosecutor ultimately requests, be it in the form of a deferred prosecution agreement or some other type of resolution, because even if that company believes it is totally innocent, that the prosecutor is one of the knuckleheads referred to and totally off the reservation, you can't afford to roll the dice. And if we have a system where we all know going in that one of the parties to the process cannot afford to take advantage of a jury trial, of the presumption of innocence, of requiring the government to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, then the system's broken. And on the corporate side, I believe the system is broken. And what we really need to do is talk to the professors, talk to the policymakers, and really have a discussion about first principles. Because if we're going to continue to permit a regime that says corporations can be charged, then you have to tinker with it to make sure that, doggone it, corporations can defend themselves without the threat of the death penalty. And the discussion during the last panel about the benefits of holding a gun to a corporation's head, I mean that's just so, I suggest it's so inconsistent with the, you know, whole notion of proportionality and fairness, because what we are talking about on the corporate side is, in many instances, a death penalty for, let's assume it's not petty fraud. Let's assume it's fraud, but it still shouldn't be a death penalty. And so I think we do need to have a discussion about whether the present system makes any sense.
I just want to intervene. I want to ask other panelists if they want to comment on that, but I want to intervene here. In the federal system, lots of defendants can't afford to roll the dice with mandatory minimum penalties and tough guidelines and that they would face if they went to trial and were convicted. They have to plead guilty, and prosecutors know that, and they do plead guilty, and we get trials in a tiny percentage of cases. So it's nice that we're all concerned about that for corporations. It's a broader phenomenon, I would just note.
Okay, may I just comment on that? I think it's very different, though, because the corporation, it's not just they can't afford to fight it. They have no defense. I mean, assuming that one single employee, however low down the organization, has committed the crime. That's it. Game over. You tell that to a CEO and a board that says, yeah, but this guy, you know, bad apple, maybe even one bad apple low down in the organization. We're going to fight this thing in court. I said, you don't have a defense as a legal matter. You have to rely on jury nullification. So that's a much wider swath, I think, than individuals face.
I also think that there's a big difference than in individual cases, because here the supposed death penalty is collateral. Right, the punishment that a corporation receives if it pleads guilty or is convicted is, you know, it's a fine, maybe organizational probation, which wouldn't look that different maybe than a deferred prosecution agreement. It's the collateral consequences to the corporation that may be the death penalty for some firms. But that's really something that may not be in the control of prosecutors. It has to do with debarment or government contracting requirements. And for some firms, a guilty plea or a conviction is not a death penalty. Right, in contexts where the firm's business is not reputation sensitive, or in a context where they know that they're not going to be debarred from government contracting because they're a crucial defense contractor, right? And so, you know, but it is, you know, you would never see in individual cases a demand from the groups representing potential targets that prosecutors establish guidelines for prosecution announcing their enforcement priorities, that they revise those guidelines periodically to reflect concerns among the constituent target, potential targets, right? There's a unique dynamic in this context. One last thing which I just wanted to mention is that not only may the U.S. approach be unique, but it, for better or for worse, and may be influential, you know, more countries around the world are adopting, for example, analogs to the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. So, you know, our approach may be, we may be alone now, but it may be influential in some respects.
Well, I also think you can't really have the discussion without looking at what it is the government actually tries to accomplish in these agreements. And I have to say, sort of being a recovering government employee, I'm not quite sure what my thinking is on this anymore, but or it's evolving and may change between now and
then. Some of us
are
totally recovered.
I realize that. So my remarks may change over the course of the panel, but you know, part of the debate obviously has to turn on what the government actually tries to accomplish in these agreements. And in many of the agreements that I was involved in while at the SEC, the goal was, what can we do to prevent this from happening again at this place? And two, what can we do industry-wide to try to improve the level of behavior in the industry? And the goal was to do that in a way that was consistent with the company's business initiatives as well, and not to interfere with it. And I think if you looked across the spectrum of the types of agreements, you would find many that struck that balance, that were really tailored to addressing the compliance infrastructure, either creating more infrastructure, creating more procedures, putting the company in a position where it had to spend more resources on compliance procedures that it otherwise would choose not to. And that for the most part, I didn't find all that much resistance from companies to those kinds of changes. And in fact, many of them had either already implemented them or would come to us offering to implement them. And there would be some negotiating further to try to make sure that we were getting some real safety procedures in place, that it wasn't just window dressing. There were other settlements. You know, the one that comes to mind most is in the analyst research area, where there was, I think, a more fundamental effort to actually change the business and the way it conducted its business. And I think there is, as a result, more of a debate today about whether those were the proper approaches to take, and if so, whether the right balance was struck in those cases. And so I think in order to really have the debate, you've got to think about, well, what is it we're trying to accomplish? If the goal is, well, let's just try to make sure people don't cross over the line in the future, I think that's a relatively non-controversial proposition. If the proposition, though, is this business line, this business model doesn't work, it is too rife with conflicts, we need to change the way the business operates, that's a much bigger leap for the government to take, and I think a much harder undertaking to try to do correctly. Because, frankly, you know, then you get into these issues about, is somebody in the government, is anybody really capable of making the judgments and the fine-tuning of an industry that would enable you to do that right?
I want to hear from Sam, but I just mentioned that, Mark, I'm going to come back to you. I don't know if you were speaking there of collaboration with U.S. attorneys' offices, or if you were speaking of settlements and agreements reached by the SEC. I want to come back to the latter question. Is there really such a big difference here? But first, we'll hear from Sam.
So just getting back to Kate's question at the outset about sort of what's fundamentally going on with corporate criminal liability. My view is that we haven't talked enough, or at least not talked frankly enough, about what I think is really at the root of this, which is this idea of a reputational sanction. It's really the only thing that distinguishes criminal liability from civil liability. Now, I realize not as a practical matter. There are lots of practical things about the criminal process that are very different. But when we look at the menu of sanctions that are available, obviously we can't imprison a firm. What criminal adds to civil is a reputational sanction. And that's something that I think we're deeply ambivalent about. On the one hand, some of us, or lots of us, like aspects of it, because it is actually something that criminal can impose over and above civil. It gives a mode of intervention into the firm that doesn't exist or doesn't exist to the same degree outside the criminal process. And particularly when people are looking at industries or eras or regions from a regulatory standpoint and coming to the conclusion that monetary sanctions aren't getting the job done. For one reason or another, they're not getting the message across that needs to be gotten across. This reputational sanction becomes a very attractive thing. And, you know, lots of what Jim Comey talked about was the message that criminal sends to firms. Well, that's because of the reputational sanction, right? But it's also the reputational sanction that leads to these concerns that Ted articulated about not being able to control the process, not being able to control what happens as a result of a criminal case. And when you think about it, a reputational sanction is a very weird thing in the criminal context, because normally it's something that we worry about. Right, we have grand jury secrecy, we have rules about what prosecutors can say at press conferences when there are indictments. We have other things that we do that are sort of intended to kind of protect people, at least in part, from the reputational effects of the criminal process. In the corporate context, we actually try to exploit that to some degree. And then we worry a lot about it, because it's a Pandora's box, and when we open it, it can take down a whole firm, and we can't control it. Because it's fundamentally a social sanction. It's not something a judge calibrates. It's not something a prosecutor negotiates in an agreement. I think part of what's been going on in the DPA context is an effort by people to kind of harness this reputational sanction. That there's this idea that, well, if we do a DPA and we require an admission of criminality, but we don't impose a full-blown criminal prosecution with an indictment, a guilty plea, a trial, and all of that, maybe we get some of that effect, but not too much of it. And I think, you know, the impulse towards that is probably a good impulse. Whether the DPA process is succeeding in that regard, I don't know. I think maybe we ought to think about some other ways we might harness that reputational sanction, including by thinking about whether there are ways that the civil process, the civil regulatory process, as opposed to the, you know, plaintiff's liability lawsuits, could get some of that reputational effect without unleashing the, you know, the kind of tiger from the cage that everybody is concerned about. Now, there's one other problem with this, right, which is that, which also I think Eric Korngold alluded to a little bit, but is the sort of turning the car around thing, right, where for this reputational sanction to have impact and to be harnessed such that we can negotiate dispositions that, you know, walk back from the brink, there has to be some credibility to the existence of the reputational sanction and the fact that it will actually be used or could be used. Only by unleashing the tiger fully from the cage can we have that kind of credible threat, and you know, that becomes a problem. Now, I don't know whether all of this leads to, you know, people to the conclusion, well, okay, you're just making an argument that we should scrap corporate criminal liability because it's too problematic. I don't actually believe that. I think we should do more thinking about this reputational sanction and how to deal with it, how to control it, how to exploit it.
Thank you. And Sam's writings, including his article for today's event, discusses some of that and bringing the civil and criminal together to a better place than either one may be. But let me put those big issues to the side for a moment. I'm sure we're going to come back to them. And find out a little bit of history about DPAs and NPAs. So we've had corporate criminal liability for a long time. We've had prosecutors who are able to have deferred prosecutions for a long time. We've seen it in the individual context for at least decades. I'm going to turn to Mary Jo White first. And
this is called the torture Mary Jo question.
No, Mary Jo, I'm going to ask you to do unrecover a little bit.
Okay.
I want you to get back, you know, off the wagon.
Back to the dark side.
Yeah.
Okay.
Put that hat back on, Mary Jo.
Okay.
And tell us how the DPA developed.
Okay. I think it's my confessional now, I guess. I believe that when I was U.S. attorney in the Southern District of New York, we actually did the first deferred prosecution agreement against a company. I think it was in 1994, perhaps. It involved essentially a large-scale alleged bond offering fraud. And its terms included lots of the terms that everybody objects to now as being too draconian and too sweeping, including requiring that, in effect, a monitor, outside monitor, also be appointed as an outside independent director to the board, report to the government on various compliance enhancements that were required. It also included appointing an outside law firm who had not worked for this particular company to review their entire compliance mechanism and report to the government. I think it was a three-year term, but others in the audience probably recall that. I mean, and I guess just to, you know, putting the prosecutorial hat back on, you know, how did I think about corporate criminal liability when I was a prosecutor? In a very misguided way, I'll say, but passing that piece. I think Jim Comey is right to a point, and Sam is right to a point, that nothing focuses the corporate attention like the threat of an indictment. I think it is the fact that there is that threat, and it is so credible because it is like shooting fish in a barrel because of corporate criminal liability. It's been overused and abused, I think. And I think it's not just in terms of indictments of companies, but in a number of the, and maybe in the numbers of, deferred prosecution agreements and the terms that they have. So, I mean, I think that's a, you know, that's a real problem there. I think you have to be able to, and as U.S. attorney, I think I've counted this right, I actually indicted four entities and did one deferred prosecution agreement. So what makes you do one or the other? You think very, very hard about the collateral consequences to the company because, you know, at the end of the day, your job as a prosecutor is to serve the public interest, and it is most often not in the public interest to destroy a company, no matter how many employees it has. It can be. You can have a company that is, you know, has a terrible history. You know, fraud has permeated the company. It still does. Maybe the best thing in the world for the public interest for a company, actually, if it does suffer the collateral consequence of going out of existence, you know, perhaps that isn't the greatest miscarriage. I think before you think about a deferred, though, and Lenny Orland points this out, I mean, we've forgotten about, you know, what ought to be the, in the vast, vast majority of cases, the what the government does, and that is to decline as to the company. Not require a non-prosecution agreement, not require a deferred prosecution agreement. Companies generally cooperate. You can have something, nobody hears today of the cooperation agreement. There is such a thing as a cooperation agreement, if that's the major goal. So, you know, when you do a deferred prosecution agreement, I think it ought to be generally in a situation where you've decided as a prosecutor you would indict, but for some reasons, mainly for the collateral consequences. Or in a narrow band of cases, close to the decision to indict, perhaps, you know, not completely over the line of indicting but for the collateral consequences, but there's a specific compliance history, compliance problem, absence of, forget about an effective compliance program, there's no compliance program, and you think you can actually, you know, do some good, you know, by having a deferred prosecution agreement or a non-prosecution agreement with terms that are addressed to those particular weaknesses. What I think you've seen happening since, you know, the Enron is you have too many of these deferred prosecution agreements. I mean, you know, the declination piece is sort of, or decision is sort of skipped over. The prosecutors are also instructed since the Thompson memo, and by the way, there is no such thing as the Philip memo, which is, shows you the wisdom of Mark Philip. He insisted that it not have his name attached to it, and Larry Thompson is the happiest person in the world that there's, you know, it's not the Thompson memo anymore. But the instruction is to federal prosecutors, and they vary in experience and sophistication as to what they know about corporations and how they operate. But to look at, in every single case of corporate crime, decide whether this company should be charged or not. In the old days, and I think there's a little bit of difference in the wording of the old Holder memo on this, unless you had a pervasive problem that really went way up in the company, went, you know, to top management, that question was not a real question on the table. Why does that matter? It matters because I think because of the various factors that you want to get a good grade on as a company, what prosecutors do now is they start grading you from the outset on your cooperation and the other, you know, factors in the principles of federal prosecution. even in a situation where there shouldn't be a realistic risk of an indictment. So I think it's been overblown. Obviously, some of the terms that we'll talk about some more and have already talked about, I think, are particularly troublesome. But let's bring back also the corporate declination decision.
And I think Jim Comey referred to the contract he reached, which was essentially a cooperation agreement, as another alternative. Ted, let me ask you. I know you don't like corporate criminal liability, but given we haven't, aren't you glad that the choice isn't simply indictment or not indict? Because in cases particularly where there is no civil enforcement agency, whether it's foreign corrupt practices or other areas, there will inevitably be cases on the margin which are indicted if that's your only choice. Isn't it better to have this continuum, indict, DP, NP, cooperation agreement, as a defense attorney?
Yeah, sure. Look, as a policy matter, I think most people would agree that it's better that prosecutors and regulations have a menu from which to choose from in terms of how to respond to various situations, and that one size fits all is not a good idea in the area of regulation or criminal prosecution. The problem I have as a practical matter really echoes what Mary Jo was getting at, that the game has changed. In the old days, the issue was whether or not the conduct in the company was so pervasive that it would merit criminal prosecution of the corporation, a la Michael Milken's group at Drexel Burnham. Today, because my good friend Mary Jo had the creativity to invent without any discussion from anybody else except in the corner office, this animal that has kind of taken over our business, the deferred prosecution agreement. The rules have changed from a situation where corporations would only be charged if you had this pervasiveness, if it went to the top, clearly people had crossed the bright line, to today where if the government has put a lot of time into an investigation of a company, very often the starting point is, well, we're going to do you a favor. We're not going to indict you, but we're going to let you sign on to this deferred prosecution agreement. And, you know, we just read about one in New Jersey, and they've got monitors and contributions to law schools and whatever. And, you know, we want to improve on that, so we're going to have two monitors, and next time we'll have three monitors. It's not a lot of checks and balances going on. Prosecutors Act, I'm very serious, like they're doing you a favor to give you the deferred, when if you use the old rule, you probably shouldn't have been indicted in the first place. But again, it all goes back to the fact that prosecutors know we're just groveling as defense lawyers. You know, if they want to pull the trigger, there's nothing we can do but just ultimately just cave. I mean, we cannot go to the board of directors and say, well, you know, Eric Korngold said that nobody's really serious about turning the car around, that it's just a threat to, you know, impact conduct. You can't say that because the boards don't want to hear that. And ultimately, you know, you sit there and you try to make what you think are principled policy arguments, but the balance of power has shifted in such a way that we're just groveling.
So sticking still with the content and the substance of these DP agreements, I actually want to turn to Brandon. I know you've looked at these in detail. You have some numbers. How often do these have the types of provisions that Ted referred to and Mary Jo referred to? And what does a typical agreement look like?
Well, there have been more than 100 of these agreements, and about two-thirds of them involve some kind of implementation of a compliance program. Many of the ones that do not, sort of mentioned in the press release or something like that, that we credit their creation of a compliance program at this firm, you know, along the way towards self-reporting and cooperating with prosecutors. A little more than half involve the appointment of monitors, and some of the ones that don't involve appointment of monitors similarly sort of credit, oh yes, we know that you've retained the following law firm or independent compliance consultant, therefore we're not going to require that you put in place a monitor because basically you already have one. Also, something that hasn't come up so much today, about two-thirds also involve the close cooperation of some kind of a regulatory agency. And so many of them involve that regulatory agency in the implementation agreement of the agreement, the selection of the monitor. Certainly some of these investigations started out in the regulatory agency and then at some point moved over to the criminal side. Now, sort of the area in which the non-academics can tell us, you know, more about is sort of what's the implementation of these agreements like? What do they look like? You know, all we see is the text of these agreements. And every once in a while, something spills out into the newspapers where there's some controversy involving that becomes public involving a particular action a monitor took. But as the last panel mentioned, you know, we don't see these monitor reports. So Lisa Griffin mentioned sort of maybe there'll be a movement in favor of more transparency. But it's not like in some SEC consent decrees where you see what the monitor has been doing. We don't know. You know, I've heard anecdotally situations in which, you know, monitors may be quite involved in corporate governance. I've also heard anecdotally about situations in which the company goes to the prosecutor after a year or two and say, hey, you know, are you ever going to appoint a monitor? You know, we did sign this agreement. You know, should we be implementing it? You know, and it may very much vary from office to office how seriously the deferred prosecution agreement is taken once there's the press release and everyone shakes hands and smiles. And so, you know, we really don't, it's very hard to gauge the effectiveness, which I know we're going to turn to later, of these agreements. You know, all we can talk about really is sort of what the text of these agreements say, but that may disguise quite a bit of variation in terms of how they're actually operating on the ground.
Mark, if I could turn to you and ask you, how does the content of these agreements differ from what the SEC might do? And I've heard that the SEC began emulating this monitoring and compliance that were in the DPAs over at the Department of Justice now are showing up, or for the last few years have been showing up in SEC settlement agreements. Tell us, how is it any different than the civil agreement?
In many cases, there's absolutely no difference. A lot of these cases tend to be investigated and charged in parallel form by the Department of Justice and the SEC, and consequently get settled in very parallel form. And so if both agencies are involved and reach a settlement, typically the DPA will mirror the civil settlement to a T. And consequently, even when DOJ is not involved and the SEC is then settling cases unilaterally with companies, they typically tend to follow that same kind of model when it comes to settling and imposing similar kinds of compliance undertakings, oftentimes some kind of compliance monitor or independent compliance consultant, either to be in place for a period of time or to come in periodically thereafter, say once a year or every 2 years, to do a compliance review and report to the SEC on the results of that. The SEC sometimes sits astride in a unique position in the sense that they work with the DOJ on some cases. They also work with the New York Attorney General's office on many cases. And so consequently, they also can end up working out settlements with the New York Attorney General's office and the other side, which is where you tend to see the settlements that take on more of a company and industry-wide reform type of approach. And in those cases as well, there often is some kind of reporting follow-up, which involves getting reports and some kind of review and follow-up and ensuring that the company is actually doing what it said it would do. So the actual content will vary depending on the context, but often they are very similar to what the criminal prosecutors do.
Can I just make one point? In the parallel proceedings, often you do have, as Mark says, an agreement with the Department of Justice and the SEC. You might just step back and say, well, what's wrong with this picture? Why do you need two agreements with two different regulators with the same terms? They aren't always identical. And, you know, one of the arguments that you have available to you as representing a company in a DOJ investigation is there's been an adequate civil alternative. Well, you know, that seems, again, to have sort of fallen by the boards with all these DPAs. You don't, you know, they both, all the agencies want something to take away from it. And I think that, again, is something that, you know, has been overdone. I mean, you don't need three different agreements with three different sets of regulators, often cooperating imperfectly, if I may say it that way.
Yeah, well, I think also it raises, it's a variation on the debate we've been having, but it has to do with the whole criminalization of civil misconduct, arguably, one of the collateral effects of the whole Enron WorldCom era was a heightened level of scrutiny by criminal prosecutors of misconduct that arguably ought to just be the province of an agency like the SEC. And it can sometimes interfere with a process that otherwise could work perhaps at a less escalated level, but achieve the same result. But I don't see that trend reversing, and I think if anything, that's only going to keep, it's either going to sustain itself or keep increasing. But I think one thing that DOJ would do well to consider is trying to distinguish those cases which are adequately handled by a civil agency and don't need the involvement of a criminal prosecutor in order to address the situation adequately. But, you know, given this media and political environment, it's very hard to decline to do something when something is in the headlines.
Before we move on to a process, I wanted to ask Sam a question. Sam, you mentioned in your opening remark there that this is not necessarily a death penalty for every firm. Maybe I'm wondering if one reason people think it is, maybe there's been an overreaction because of the Arthur Andersen case. You want to speak on that?
Well, I'll plead guilty to having been involved in the Arthur Andersen case. So Jim Comey's not here to give me my acceptance of responsibility points, unfortunately. That's a complicated story. It takes a long time to tell, so I'm not going to go off on that. But I do think that it depends very much on the nature of the firm. It depends on the nature of the allegations. Anderson obviously was in a very, very vulnerable position following the collapse of Enron for a variety of reasons, including the prospect of criminal charges. It's hard to untangle all the causal factors that went into that situation. I do think, though, that I watched the KPMG prosecution from afar, from a seat in academia, and it looked like, I don't know if anybody here was involved in that case directly, but it looked to me like there was some real brinkmanship that went down right to the wire in the negotiation of that case and as to whether it was going to end in a DPA or an indictment. And it was clear that the Arthur Andersen case hung as a major shadow over that entire process, for good or ill. But KPMG was also an audit firm, also a partnership. The allegations were a little different, tax shelter improprieties as opposed to document destruction and audit failures. But I think it depends a lot on the nature of the firm. And again, I think this reputational sanction is something that we don't have a good handle on, not just in the sense that the legal system has no way of kind of controlling it, but that we just don't understand it that well as an empirical matter. It's not clear. I mean, there's been some academic work done on reputational sanctions, and it generally what it does is it looks at what happens to a firm's stock price after it's been charged by the SEC or there's been a criminal allegation and so forth. And that's some good evidence, obviously. But stock prices are complicated things, right? A lot of things go into that. Nobody thinks the markets are, fundamentally efficient. Is that really a good proxy for determining, what the effect is on a firm? And even there, it's very hard to untangle. you know, how much of what we're witnessing is a result of what the market is concluding about the firm because of the nature of the conduct, and how much of it is the legal process itself that is imposing some additional effect that wouldn't be there otherwise. Probably some of both, but how do we measure the relative contribution of the two things? So I guess my bottom line is I don't think you can answer the question about the death penalty in a general or abstract way. I think it's going to have to depend on the case.
You know, in practice, sometimes a company will choose a charge, you know, rather than a draconian deferred prosecution agreement. I mean, it does depend on the offense, and certainly depends on the kind of company it is. If it's an accounting firm where reputation is all important, you're not going to make that choice. But I think because of how draconian the terms of some of these DPAs have been, you know, you do make the choice occasionally as a company to, you know, environmental offenses are fairly common on the criminal side. In the healthcare fraud area, that's, you know, becoming more common, you know, than DPAs, I think. And you know, it's interesting about the reputational hit, and you're right, it's very hard to ferret that out. You know, your employees don't want to work at a company that's been indicted. I mean, that's a big factor, actually, when you think about this. On the other hand, if you read, you know, many, many of the media reports, as soon as Eric's office files a, you know, Martin Act civil suit, or the SEC files a civil securities fraud, it's Company X charged with fraud. Prosecutors, even though they're not prosecutors in that capacity, they're actually civil attorneys, doesn't get reported that way. So there's a real, you know, reputational hit and a lot of leverage that comes from the civil side, too.
I was hoping, I don't know if you want to talk about an example that you worked on, but I thought it was an interesting example, right, where I don't know that people are going to refuse to buy a coffee maker from a particular company just because they happen to be involved in allegations of foreign corrupt practices, right? I think that might be another area where it's a different kind of reputation, right? It's not the reputation that's related to a certain piece of the company's business, and so they may be able to isolate it.
I don't want to talk about specific cases, but just, I mean, there's several out there. I mean, I'm sure Ted has some in his experience, too.
The KPMG case was mentioned, and this, I want to use that as a segue into talking about what processes should be undertaken. I guess we're going to focus on the federal level here in deciding whether to indict a company or whether to enter into any other of these arrangements. It was reported that the KPMG deferred prosecution agreement was dictated by Maine Justice over the objections or the contrary recommendation of the U.S. attorney here. I don't know if that's accurate. If anybody wants to shed light on it, I'd be curious. But the broader question is, who should make the decision? Should there be nationwide guidelines centralized in DOJ? Jim touched on this this morning, and of course he had a different perspective depending on where he was sitting. Or should it be done regionally in connection with the civil agency, and in which case really the SEC in Washington is going to end up deciding rather than DOJ in Washington. It's a complex question, and I'm going to ask anyone who has knowledge or views to please respond.
Look, I think from the perspective of a criminal defense lawyer, you always want, in theory, as much review as you can get. And to the extent you feel the system may be broken, you would prefer to have built into the system a requirement with respect to a deferred prosecution or the indictment of a public company that the U.S. attorney would have to go and get approval from the Department of Justice, or at a minimum, if you want a meeting, you would be guaranteed review at the Department of Justice. What I've seen recently during the Bush administration, Justice Department, I saw situations where things moved a bit too quickly because you were not guaranteed review at DOJ, and in certain situations, though they said we would meet with you, the time was compressed in such a way that I don't think the meeting was really meaningful in the same way it would have been as if review were required or approval were required. And sometimes you can get into those time problems where you got due process in theory, but the reality was you were put in a corner and the gun was at your head, and you know you had 24 hours to either be shot or agree to the ransom.
I mean, I agree. I mean, I think is certainly this would have been anathema to me as a U.S. attorney in the so-called sovereign district of New York to say that Maine justice ought to exercise more control over anything, mind you. And by and large, that's still probably correct. But on this score, what Maine justice has done is to they have a mechanism now, some procedures surrounding the choice of who the monitor is, you know, responding to you know specific situations there. But what there isn't yet, and I think we thought perhaps there was from some of the materials that, that I saw in connection with this panel, that there was, that there isn't even, as I understand it, a consultation requirement before individual U.S. attorneys decide to enter into a deferred prosecution agreement or a review of the terms, you know, by and large. I think it would be helpful if there were. I mean, it's like everything else. You have 93, you know, U.S. attorney's offices of various sophistication and prosecutorial philosophy. And just you know, one you know, quick war story in the 90s when the, I think it was in 1996. There was a big conference of defense attorneys, a couple of U.S. attorneys, Maine justice, and we were talking about. I was talking about actually the history in the Southern District of New York with respect to charging companies that engaged in by myself, but also Rudy Giuliani and Otto Obermeyer. That the Southern District had always made an effort to put out a press release when they either, so long as the investigation was a matter of public record already, why they charged or didn't charge a company to provide some guidance. We'd like to see cooperation. They remediated, whatever it may be. The defense attorneys pretty unanimously urged the Department of Justice to develop written guidelines for all of the U.S. attorney's offices. That became the Holder memo, the Thompson memo, the McNulty memo. I, at least as one of the people in the room who'd been a lawyer for companies as well as a prosecutor, said, be very careful. You know, you don't ask for something that you're really going to regret having because, you know, those guidelines are only as good as the prosecutor's expertise and discretion is. And you essentially empowered the entire field to, you know, with these various factors that they've used now to, in effect, coerce in many instances, in some places, deferred prosecution agreements, heretofore waivers of the privilege and so forth. So I think you need that oversight.
You know, it's an interesting history because, as Mary Jo said, we within the defense bar actually asked for DOJ to set forth these principles. And to many of us, they became a nightmare. And for those of us who go back and were involved in that, one of the things that continues to give us concern about asking for more rules and guidance on deferred prosecution agreements is we remember we asked for similar guidance with respect to the Holder memo, and we ended up creating this regime that many of us have spent years fighting because implicit in the Holder terms and the Thompson terms and Phillip terms, there was this coercive nature. And I listened to the prior panel with respect, say, to the issue of attorney's fees, and it seems like, oh, everything's hunky-dory. But I will tell you, if you look at what happened, we have been discussing issues like that in terms of the coercive effects, the impact on attorney's fees, impact on joint defense agreements, impact on assertions of the Fifth for years in panels like this, trying to get some traction. And then Judge Kaplan, and really what was an extraordinarily courageous decision for which he took all sorts of heat from various circles when he wrote it. Now he's applauded and it seems everybody accepts, oh, this was something we shouldn't have been doing. But it didn't come about because of, you know, some bright light suddenly at DOJ. It came about because a federal judge really went against the tide and wrote this opinion, and now today, you know, we've seen, oh, the system will correct itself. I don't buy that. I think we've got to keep having these conferences and keep talking about these issues. I mean, Kaplan certainly dealt with the attorney's fee issue. I continue to rail personally against the notion of corporations sanctioning their employees who dare to assert the Fifth Amendment. Most corporations sanction people who take the Fifth, not because the board of directors really gives a doggone, but because they're concerned about the Holder memo, the Thompson memo, and the cooperation box.
So there's a more general point here, if I could make a professorial point before turning to a colleague. So you want to control discretion, and you say, well, let's get some rules to control the discretion and make sure it's all done uniformly and wisely. It really depends on the content of those rules, and we saw it in the Holder memo or the Thompson memo, and of course also in the sentencing guidelines. And more general phenomenon, I think it's very hard to control discretion without saying don't exercise it. And what that means is charge or use your power. And so there's a broader issue. Sam?
Yeah, I was going to make a very similar point. I mean, I think that from the standpoint of system design, you know, the perspective that law professors take, I also have got a new perspective now, Mary Jo. You know, we would think, well, yeah, of course you want a system that looks, you know, from the top down at all the possible liability mechanisms that are there and tries to create a coordination among them. And here it's not just criminal and SEC. Let's take a securities case just as an example. It's also the private lawsuits, right? And they affect, and maybe bankruptcy if that's on the table. And they all affect each other in really fundamental ways that can create distortions and perverse incentives of all sorts. So you would want to have a mechanism for coordinating that. And I think that one of the reasons why we ended up where we are now is because federal prosecutors tend to think of themselves as kind of problem solvers. You know, they're not system designers. They're sort of, where do we see an issue and a need to intervene because the system's not dealing with something? You know, let's start using the RICO statute against urban gangs because the homicide rate is out of control in New York and the state system is not, you know, doesn't seem to be having the right impact. Or let's use the mail fraud statute to deal with some public corruption problem that, you know, state system's not dealing with. Similarly, I think that's, you know, part of what was going on here is a kind of a looking at the civil and saying, well, this doesn't seem to be getting it done. Let's be creative. How else can we deal with this? I assume that's part of what the thinking was in Mary Jo's, you know, era in terms of developing these things. Obviously, that's not optimal. You'd rather have, instead of a sort of reactive problem-solving mindset, you'd rather have a system design kind of ex-ante perspective. We have multiple forms of liability. How should we get them working together? The trouble with that is, you know, and this gets to Kate's point, is you then have to think about how's that process going to actually work. And it seems to me it can only work through the legislative process. I don't really see how you can get private securities fraud liability, SEC investigations, DOJ cases, and maybe bankruptcy proceedings kind of functioning as a unit without some kind of a legislative intervention. And if that's the case, then you really have to worry about what is that legislative process going to look like? Whose interests are going to prevail in that discussion? Are the people who are engaging in that discussion going to have any more expertise or less relative to the people who are kind of doing it on an ad hoc basis now? And you sort of end up back at kind of, I think, the, you know, sort of the typically the Southern District perspective, which is leave us alone, we're on the ground, we know how this stuff works, we've got a good relationship with the defense bar, let us work it out. Don't try to intervene from the top with system design. You're only going to screw it up.
We're not going to get to the effectiveness question on this panel. I just, for later in the day, AIG, Citi, Citigroup, Lehman Brothers, these were all subjects of earlier efforts that we're discussing today, and look what's happened. So that's for later. I think now I'm going to ask whether there are questions that should be addressed to this panel. We'll have panels on state versus federal and panels on monitors. Could you please go to the microphone and also speak loudly so the people in the back can hear you? That's the problem. It wasn't on, apparently.
Yeah, I think it's on now. Good morning. I'm Joe Rossinello. I'm the U.S. Attorney in San Francisco, the person that they referred to here as the outlander. There are a couple of things I just wanted to mention and then ask you this question. Dave Margolis, who is the sage of the Department of Justice, been around forever, says that in his experience, when Republicans were appointed U.S. attorneys, he had to convince them that there was a Department of Justice. And when Democrats were appointed, he had to convince them that they actually had power.
That's wrong.
It is. Well, it brings up something else, which is also true. The Department of Justice is divided into three parts: the FBI, the Southern District of New York, and everybody else. But I wanted to ask you this: in the wake of Sarbanes-Oxley, and given that you now have monitors literally inside all public corporations, don't you think that the likelihood of a corporation being able to argue for a deferred prosecution is significantly diminished as compared to the time before then, when it could argue that it really didn't have knowledge of what rogue employees of other, or divisions of the company were doing?
I mean, I think I don't agree with that, actually. I mean, I think it makes the argument in that area more difficult. In other words, before you had the sentencing guidelines, you still had this issue of corporate criminal liability. But then when you had the seven steps to heaven or whatever as to what an effective compliance program is, and you didn't have that after you were put on notice that that existed, you know, that argument is not persuasive as to why you should be treated more leniently by way of a deferred prosecution agreement. But you still have all the arguments that I think is really where the rubber meets the road, and that is, how serious is the offense? How pervasive is it? How high up does it go? And then, very importantly, collateral consequences. What are they if there was to be an indictment? And isn't there an alternative to that that doesn't have those negative collateral consequences for the company, the public, and others, that really does satisfy law enforcement? So I don't see the debate really changing. That argument is a little harder, maybe.
Yeah, and I think if you look, for example, at the FCPA area, FCPA has exploded in prosecutions in the last few years. And it has, and all since Sarbanes-Oxley, and it has fostered a sort of cottage industry in FCPA compliance consulting. You know, there are law firms and other types of firms, accounting firms, that will come into businesses, and they're making a lot of money doing this, of helping companies get their FCPA compliance programs up to speed, because 5 years ago, you know, it wasn't something companies really focused on all that much. And as a consequence, there were a lot of companies that made it possible because of the absence of sufficient internal controls for operations around the globe to prevent employees from paying out cash to people in foreign countries for business. And so several high-profile, big-ticket prosecutions with the accompanying deferred prosecution agreements of the companies have gotten everyone else now to be much more focused on what they need to do to avoid being in that situation in the future.
A question for you, though. What I've heard some prosecutors say, though, is, which goes to the question from the, is that precisely because of the Sarbanes-Oxley requirements, more firms are learning about patterns of foreign bribery, and they're therefore self-reporting. I don't know if you observe a link like that.
Well, there certainly is a lot more self-discovery and self-reporting going on. Part of it probably is due to Sarbanes-Oxley. Part of it, I think, is also due to, you know, greater levels of attention paid to the issue. And a lot of the times it comes up, frankly, in, you know, when there's a corporate transaction, you know, an acquisition, one, and there's due diligence that takes place, or, you know, one company with a particularly robust program of compliance acquires a company that didn't necessarily, and they find things that weren't previously uncovered. So I simply make the point to throw out the idea that I think Sarbanes-Oxley has actually done a lot to improve the level of compliance. You know, one of the things I always found was just making people certify on a financial statement and put their name on it under oath has actually a very powerful effect on getting them to get people below them to certify to them, and so on and so on. so that I think things like that actually have had a powerful effect.
Mentioning Sarbanes-Oxley raises a broader issue, and that is what is the best way to achieve the desired public policy ends? And there are lawsuits, they're tort suits, or they're derivative actions that could be brought. There's industry-specific regulations, such as the SEC engages in, or the EPA, or and there are broader legislative interventions, such as the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act that criminalized something. Of course, some of the Sarbanes-Oxley requirements that we've just been discussing. And it may be that, prosecutors jumped in and were playing a bigger role because some of the other agencies were just doing things as they had done them in previous decades and hadn't sort of updated and looked around. And because Congress was busy doing whatever Congress usually does. And I'm wondering if, I know Brandon has views on this.
I think this brings back to a question that you raised earlier, but none of us really answered it, which is, do we want nationwide guidelines or best practices as to the content of compliance reform in these agreements? And we talked about the sort of be careful what you wish for aspect of guidelines in general, but specifically as to the content of what kinds of reform occurs in these agreements. Now, I mean, there are areas where prosecutors have long taken on a sort of a structural reform mission, and that was sort of where I first became interested in this area, thinking about, they're doing the same kinds of things that they do when they come in to reform broken prisons or police departments. Or Jim Jacobs has written wonderful work about the RICO trustees that took on jobs which, maybe dwarf some of the agreements in these cases. There's been a lot of talk about, and these memos have addressed a lot of issues relating to sort of the rights of individual employees, attorney's fees, privilege, Fifth Amendment issues. Those have been many of the concerns that have been brought up by the defense bar. But there hasn't been an effort to create a set of guidelines really dealing with the substance of these agreements, and maybe for some good reasons. The closest that we have now is sort of the statements in the Morford memo, something like, well, when do you want to have a monitor in a case? Well, maybe you want a monitor if compliance really needs a lot of help, but you don't want a monitor if it doesn't. And maybe you want the monitor to stick around for a long time if it's a really complicated case, but maybe for less time if it's a simpler case. You could have a list of best practices which doesn't tell anyone anything about what to do to avoid a prosecution. And then there's another question about whether you want the DOJ to be doing that at all. And finally, maybe if you did want it to happen, maybe you wouldn't want it to happen until now that there's been some more experience doing this kind of work. But, I'd be interested in other people's thoughts on whether we want the DOJ to actually acknowledge a role as system designers here, or whether we want them to just sort of keep doing it on an ad hoc basis if they're going to stay in this business.
Well, I mean, I think prosecutors, are at their best when they prosecute or they don't. And if you stray very far from that, you're on, a very slippery slope, I think. Although there's no question that you see your duty, I think, as a prosecutor, at least being informed by whether you think there's sufficient other sanctions out there short of, let us say, a criminal indictment. I mean, in the securities fraud area, for example, you obviously have the SEC that can bring fraud charges against an individual. Maybe that's happened a couple times and the same individual's back again. Well, quite routinely, you'll decide then that you need the club of the criminal prosecution in that situation. What we're talking about here is some is different in a sense, but if a prosecutor perceives that all the civil and regulatory mechanisms have really failed pervasively in the system, and you need to send a strong message. You don't, I think, from a public point of view, want to deprive, prosecutors, not that anybody's going to do that anyway, I think, from the ability to, ratchet up the sanction. When it comes, however, to basically rulemaking by settling enforcement actions or prosecuting with the DPA, you know, that's when I think it gets in an area where you don't come out with a good result. And I think you can't make it too uniform either, because you're trying to address a specific problem that has very different facts. When you're, you know, if you're, for example, targeting compliance weaknesses, those are going to be different in every company. So not an easy set of problems. I just think the prosecutors ought to be slow to go beyond their core role.
So, yeah, I mean, I have a reaction to that, which is a little bit related to what I was saying a minute ago, which is that it goes right to the title of this conference, right? I just don't think that we've actually thought through, even outside the corporate context, in a fundamental way, the concept of the prosecutor as a regulator. And I think even if, you know, Ray doesn't think he's regulating, I think he is. Because, you know, what we're talking about here are special kinds of prosecutors, federal prosecutors and attorney general's offices. These are not prosecutor's offices that have mandatory jurisdictions for the most part. And so it's not, you know, it's not quite, we can't quite just say, well, the prosecutor's decision here is simply whether to prosecute or not, and that's all we want them to be doing, because that suggests that it's like a DA's office's decision. You know, I've got a case, I need to decide whether I should indict it or not. I mean, everything that the federal prosecutors are doing is driven by policy decisions, right? With some limited, you know, exceptions, things that come in because they happen on federal jurisdiction, or the Mule cases from Kennedy Airport that the Eastern District can't avoid dealing with. But for the most part, everything federal prosecutors are doing is a choice. And they've got to be making those choices with an eye on whether they think they're accomplishing something useful or not. And that just seems to me, it inevitably opens up considerations of general social policies that overlap with what civil liability is doing, with overlap with what other forms of legal intervention are doing. And I don't know that that's avoidable. I don't know that we can get around that by just saying, look, stick to what you normally do, which is just deciding whether to indict the case.
Yeah, but one of the dangers of that view is that there are now so many different types of prosecutors, types of regulators who want to play the game. You could say in the old days, well, the Southern District of New York is going to be the premier prosecuting agency for regulating Wall Street, and they have a long history of working with the SEC, and we're going to defer to how those two entities work together. And then we have Elliot Spitzer becomes the Attorney General. He says, you know what, I want to play too. And then the Attorney General in Massachusetts, he says, well, Elliot Spitzer, he got his name, he's got his picture on the front of Fortune, I want to play. Then you get the guy or the woman who's the Attorney General in South Carolina, they want to play. And suddenly this presumption of expertise, of competency built up over the years, this collective competence starts to break down, because again, everybody wants to play. And that's one of the things that concerns me as a criminal defense lawyer. And I know, I assume the next panel talking about competing regulators will discuss this. You now have a system where for various reasons, you don't have the regulators necessarily having that wealth of experience. And a lot of you, and it's very hard to advise your clients, and it's just a very scary environment. And I don't know if that cuts in favor of having a national model that says the federal government and U.S. attorneys shall be the key regulators. But I have a real concern with this multiplication.
Can I just put something else on the regulators? So in the state and local regulators, instead of being checks and balances, it's just piling on. There's one other entity that we haven't mentioned that historically has played a very important role in setting standards and in changing industry standards in tort law, for instance, and in playing a role in checking the prosecutor, and that's the judge. Now, Ted mentioned Judge Kaplan. Judge Kaplan only got the case because some individuals decided not to do what 95% of individuals do, which is plead guilty. That's this is a broader issue, of course, in the federal system. Who decides what the meaning of federal criminal law is? But right now, it's federal prosecutors. And it's particularly significant, it seems to me, in this DPA area. In reading Brandon's paper, one of the cases he discusses is the false claim settlement of the knee and hip industry. So the whole knee and hip industry signed a DPA agreeing to a whole bunch of things, but the premise was that they had violated the false claim statute by engaging in certain practices. And a lot of us who look at that say, in fact, that's a misinterpretation of federal law, never got before a judge. Now, I know people think, oh, God, bring judges in here. It's really going to be a mess. But at least I want to leave on the table for future discussion whether federal judges should have some role here. And we'll have time for one question.
My question is simply, you mentioned the fact that Monitor was asked to join a board, and there have been several cases where monitors have been asked to join a board or have imposed directors on corporations. I would just ask that you comment on to whom do monitors owe their duties, and how does that marry with fiduciary duties?
Very, very good question. I mean, I think what's happening now, by the way, under the DPAs that actually require the appointment of a director, they're just a director, they're not a monitor, which makes that, at least answering that question, a little bit easier. So if you're basically, you require another director to be put on the board, they have the same fiduciary duties under Delaware law and elsewhere that all the other directors do. But in terms of the monitors, and to some extent, the Morford memo that the Department of Justice put out on appointment of monitors, you know, talks about that they basically, you know, they certainly are not a lawyer to the corporation. They often have reporting obligations, you know, to the government, and so they owe their duties as specified in the agreement. It's not a set of civil, as I see it at least now, a set of civil law liabilities. The DPA that we talked about earlier, the first one that we did, I think, you know, create in that regard created very complex issues because if you have in effect empowering, requiring the appointment of an additional director and giving them reporting responsibilities to the government, it makes it almost impossible to ferret that out. It's not a, you know, that's not the ideal model. If you need, you know, and I think actually anything that goes into corporate governance now, you know, ought to be out of these DPAs, frankly. I mean, you know, one of the tough issues with the monitors is, you know, you want them to have free flow of information, but the government now requires, at least federal government, that the company has no attorney-client privilege at all vis-a-vis the monitor. So it's basically a flow-through to the government, which can be very problematic as well. And so, by the way, just to add one quick point, this transparency of kind of what are they finding and what are the reports, you know, what are the reports saying, I mean, that, from a company's point of view, that is very troubling and beyond, I think, even the trade secrets point of view. You're trying to enhance, reform a company in compliance ways and other ways, and I think if you actually published all of the nitty-gritty on the way to that and all the detailed reports that these monitors do, you know, companies are going to be much more reluctant to, you know, engage in something, agree to something that might actually do a lot of good.
I know you'll just be concise.
Just a very quick one. Judges formally do approve deferred prosecution agreements, right? Because a prosecution before the court is being approved. And where were the judges when some of these, you know, albeit unusual agreements were approved that included, you know, the chair at Bristol-Myers? You know, judges could have taken on a little bit more of a role. Obviously, judges are deferential when they approve agreements like plea agreements, but judges, you know, with non-prosecution agreements, obviously there's nothing before the court, and so the concerns are even greater. But I think we have something to talk about. Judges could be taking on more of a role, even under the current system with deferred prosecution agreements.
Thank you all very much.